using high-dimensional data, something that Transmart is good at holding, but not necessarily utilizing in all possible ways. So take it away.
Yeah. So hi, everybody. So before I start the presentation, I want to say that this was a high collaborative project. So you have two companies here presenting. And yeah, I think it was a very good group work, as I will show also in the slides that are coming. And I'm just going to present, I'm going to give the a general overview, a little bit on the history and the background, and some, I will show a use case, and then I will leave the technical part to the expert. So, why does not move?
The right hand.
What? Does not want to move. It want to move. So, I mean, we hear a lot lately about translational research, personalized medicine, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I think this drops down to the point that, I mean, before, until now, we have, let's say, this model. So you had the patients that they had some disease. I mean, you were giving a drug, and then it was always to some of the patients it was working, some it was not, and some they even had adverse effects. Now, what we want, what we want to do in the future is that we want to utilize all this vast amount of omics data that they are out there to and molecular data that are out there to tailor and group the patients into smaller groups that then we know from the beginning which drug we will we are going to give to them. So currently we have a lot of omics data. And one of the things that we want to do is to present them in the researchers through a standardized and ready-to-use way. And I think if somebody has worked with bioinformatician or is a bioinformatician, he will know that usually 50% of our time we spend it just to try to map data from one source to another. And I think Transmart can help a lot into solving this problem. And by that, we hope that we can boost the analysis of this data and be able to fast move from clinical research to clinical, to from clinics to research and back, and to be able to use the data as the source of hypothesis generation. And yeah, at the end, what we want to do is to help the patients. And when we are talking about high-dimensional data, we are talking about a vast amount of data, actually. So here is just some of the data sources that are out there for producing high-dimensional data. So, I mean, there are all the next-generation sequencing, DNA-seq, RNA-seq, small RNA-seq, chip-seq, and I don't know how many other seqs are out there that I'm not aware of. Microarray data and also microRNA panels. And you can see that there are also a lot of public data sources that we can actually store and we can use the data from. And in the future, there are much more data expected. So we have the 100,000 genomes projects from England. And I mean, of course, US wanted to be more. So we have the 1 million people project from US. I wonder what China will do in the future. But so high-dimensional data and omics data are there to stay. So what we wanted to do is to improve the functionality of Transmart. And before I say anything else, I mean, Transmart is already support analysis and visualization of omics data. So it's not that it's nothing. In Transmart, of course, and here I just want to show an example of what we can currently do with Transmart. And this is, for example, from we have a demo version installed in Bayer. So this is from our demo versions. And here, for example, it can have a high throughput panel of proteomics panel RPPA, and it wants to, for example, we want to see if this how well it correlates with more low dimensional analysis. So, for example, immunohistochemistry. And in this example, we have breast cancer and HER2, which is overexpression of HER2. I'm sorry. The patients that are overexpressing HER2 are usually treated in a very specific way. So, for example, here we with this we could easily show that also proteomics RPPA. When you have positive, when the immunohistochemistry is marked as positive, you also have a higher expression of protein. So you can easily see, for example, that your high throughput method is well correlated with immunohistochemistry. One of the Cuke's case that appeared all between different groups and between different projects that currently Transmart is not able to address is this one. So select a cohort, sub-cohort based on clinical and demographic characteristics. This is there, but the molecular measurements were still not there. And I mean, this is a use case that we've heard. I mean, it is a question that they have within pharmaceutical companies and definitely within Bayer, within different IMI projects like Oncotrack, Trade. So I mean, the question was the there. I mean, and what was differing is what do you want to do downstream? So depending on the project, some people want to do summary statistics, some genomics analysis, some compare survival. I mean, you want to be able to find samples, sample availability or informed consent. So what is the downstream analysis? It is project, let's say, specific, but this was a common request. So what we did is that group of people from the Hive, from Trade, and from IDRIC. So this is the ones in front of the camera. Yannis is on the back taking the picture. So we're gathered all together in Brussels in order to try to define the scope and the questions and how we will move forward. So. And what we came up and what we currently have and we want to present you here is the ability of selecting. I mean, currently it works with this data, microarrays, RNA-seq, proteomics, and microRNA panels, and the ability of Transmart to select cohorts based on high-dimensional data to incorporate this data into summary statistics and in grid view. And I will go on with a use case, and this is from colorectal and prostate cell lines study that was provided by Trade, and it has a broad set of omics data, and the use case is going to be on RNA-seq data and on more specific on Illumina GA2 RNA-seq data. And because we are talking about RNA-seq, together with the functionality, we also have made the documentation and some general guidelines. So, I mean, we want to use, of course, normalized and log-normalized data and not raw. Because RNA sequencing normalization is a very dynamic field, nothing is set up. We are not, while uploading, choosing the normalization. This is left to the each project, each user. We want to allow log transformation and to allow to add a pseudocon, because whoever works with RNA-seq data, he knows that there is a zero. You can get quite often zero value, so you need to have a pseudocon in order to be able to log transform it. And we also can provide a document that describing basic normalization methods and suggestions regarding this RNA-seq. And here I just want to go over the demo. So I mean, you know, this is the comparison, the cohort selection. But one can do is until now it could actually throw in low dimensional data, but now one can throw high dimensional data, and by that it can select different genes with the autocomplete, for example, with the autocomplete function. And what you have is one can see the histogram of the distribution of the expression data. It can select the number of bins, so in order to zoom in or zoom out, and then be able to filter if it wants like the lower expression or the higher expression regime. And then can do the same thing in the summary statistics. So, for example, here you can still, so here we have, in this case, we have two cohorts, right? And we can see for a specific gene for KRAS, the distribution in one cohort and in the other. And we can see it either in histograms, that is usually easier to examine the distribution, or box plots that makes easier the comparisons. And I mean, one can continuously drop the high dimensional node and be able to select for more genes. And this is the last thing that I would like to show. So we can actually do exactly the same thing on the grid view. So you can have it. So here, for example, we had the KRAS gene, and we drag and drop the node, and we select for a TP53 gene, so we can add more information to the table. And I think here it's my part is finished. And yeah.
Thank you, Anna. So, good afternoon, everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? Okay. So, I'm Danny. I've been mostly involved in the technical side of this project. And I just want to talk a little bit on the ideas behind when developing the technical side, the ideas that we wanted to keep in mind. So first of all, one of the main things that we wanted to do was to stick with the team. So what I mean by that, that is that we want to keep the same interface of drag and drop in place for high dimensional data, the same drag and drop that users are already used to for low dimensional data. Of course, we want these queried concepts to also appear in the summary statistics and in grid view. And if possible, we want to adhere to the I2B to query definition. A small technical background on the drag and drop. I won't go too technical in my talk. But the first thing that we needed to do was to extend the web application so that it would be able to, first of all, detect the drop of a high-dimensional concept. So it needed to be able to spot the difference and then, of course, act upon it. So when it detects the drop of a high-dimensional concept, it will first ask the server for some more information on the site that's specific to this high-dimensional concept. For example, it will ask for an HTML snippet of what this filter should look like, because as we will see in the next slide, there are some quite significant differences among the different high-dimensional data types. So in the previous slide, you can see that I put filter classes. Now, what do I mean by that? So in high-dimensional data, we can actually classify the different types of data in a couple of classes. So one, the most simple type, single numeric or continuous, however you want to call it. But this basically means that for each gene or for each Myrna ID or for each protein, there's one value for each patient. So we could have gene expression or RNA-seq counts, etc. Then there's an entirely different class of high-dimensional data, the mutational data, most likely being represented in the VCF format, where we have information on the mutations. So we have a location in the genome. Do we have a deletion? Do we have addition? This is mostly not continuous data. This could be categorical. This could be binary. So an entirely different class. There's chromosomal data. We could have upregulated, downregulated chromosomes. We could have, again, deletions and this kinds of things. But there might be even other data types that will be added in the future. So queries in Transmart, when they're created by the user, internally they will be represented in an XML snippet. So this XML, it follows an A2B to patient set query definition. So it's a language that's been defined upfront to that, so that everyone uses the same XML tags. So this is a classic value constraint. This is on some continuous variable. So for example, on age, we want to select all people that have a value less than 60. Now, if we go back to our i-dimensional data, we want to look at what these constraints could look like. It again depends on the class of i-dimensional data that we're dealing with. So for the most simple type, we could have the gene symbol. We could have the type of projection. So are we defining this against the raw measurement? Are we defining this against the log measurement? Or are we even defining it against the Z-score? Because that's also stored internally in the Transmart database. And the same goes for the other high-dimensional data classes. So there are a wide range of possible values in these constraints that are not necessarily the same over the entire range of classes. So now, one of the challenges is how do we put this into this already existing framework for representing constraints? This was a bit unclear at first. So for now, we actually don't put this into this framework. Once a complete picture of all of these filter classes exist, we will revisit this problem. But for now, we will have or we will introduce our own XML tag, which is better suited to handle all of these classes. So if we go back to our filter classes, we can see that first of all, we need to know what type of high-dimensional data we're dealing with. Over one constant over all of the filter classes is that we need to define a location within the high-dimensional data. And the specific nature of high-dimensional data is that for each patient, there's a wide range of possible locations that have values. So this is something that's the same for every possible class. Here it's still called projection type, but it could be called, or it might better be called property, because in the simple single numeric class, it could be a log projection or the raw values. But over the other classes, it could be properties like quality, read depth, deletion, amplifications, etc. And then, of course, we need to define what it is on this position that we want to filter on. So in summary, we have these high-dimensional data constraints. That's for the moment still unclear on how to incorporate this into the standard I2B2 query definition. So for now, we stick to a specialized tag that we crafted to be able to capture all of the filter information. And of course, we had to build extensions to the core API in order to allow it to understand this new tag and to transform it to SQL so that we can actually get to the data. So in summary, the functionality that's already present for now is also what you saw in the demo. This is for the single numeric filter classes. So because we're looking at classes, we can have more types of high-dimensional data at once with the same pieces of code. There are still some remaining challenges that need to be tackled. We want to expand this functionality to mutational and chromosomal data. We want to add the support for pseudocounts in RNA-seq because, as Anna mentioned, there are a lot of different types of normalizations. There are different types of projections. RNA-seq uses read counts. If you want to log transform them, there will be values that are zero, which, of course, you will run into problems if you try to log a zero. We want to add support for gene signatures. At the moment, it's still a bit unclear on what's the best approach for this. Additionally, we want to add support for the R API so that researchers can, from within the R API, ask for the data of a specific gene in a high-dimensional concept so that they don't have to download the entire high-dimensional data set. And then eventually, we will reintegrate the query tags with the I2B2 definitions. And of course, this is a highly iterative process, so we will continue to further test and improve the code. As a timeline goal, we are trying to get this ready for integration with Transmart 1.3 so that everyone can enjoy this new feature. So thank you, and if there are any questions, please feel free.
Thanks, Danny and Anna. Are there any questions? Well, Tatiana, if you want to come down and prepare. We have a couple of minutes. Any questions on the high dynamic data? As Danny mentioned, this is one of the key features that we intend to build into version 1.3. Mm-hmm. So.
Exactly.
What's that?
You love it.
Okay. We have one. Okay.
One question I have is, so right now you can use one gene and looking at the histogram of that gene and then make cohorts, basically define cohorts based on one gene expression. I know you at the end, something sort of coming feature is more of having a signature based. So right now as an intermediate, I was wondering, can you manually drag, say, a couple genes?
Yes, absolutely. So you can do it just in the same way as you would do with low dimensional or just regular concepts. So you can drag them in into the same panel so they become OR constraints, or you can drag them into different panels so they become conjunctive or AND constraints. So the idea of the signatures is that researchers often have their own kind of groups of genes of interest that they're particularly interested in, and they reuse them for different kinds of trials.
Yes.
But it's only not quite clear on how this cohort selection then would work if we would give researchers access to a signature, because what are we going to filter on the average, on the top gene, on all
so
genes at once?
There's different ways of defining, even if you
exactly.
only have two or three genes.
Exactly. So,
so
this is still
a
conversation that we're having. This is still not defined on how we will do this.
Cool. All right. Thanks again.
Thank you.